over 1,000 years. It is the center of the world. Rome will not fall.
And as long as we have our Caesar, we have our heart.
Odoacer and his army of Ostrogoths have sacked the city of Ravenna. They're on their way here.
People of Rome!
Romulus has killed the snake.
Romans, citizens, once again, we've managed to bring back security to our Roman provinces.
Now, what do we do about the mongoose?
We just defeated the greatest enemy Rome has ever known.
Roma Vita!
Do you hear what our honorable patriots Majorian would
now
tell us?
Now that we've defeated Attila,
we're doomed!
It's only a matter of time that the Germans unite against us.
One last time!
You come back to me.
I've seen the barbarians. I've smelled them.
You think that you can predict the omens of Rome?
Thousands of them.
Change the will of Rome? We must negotiate a solution as the Senate always has.
Greed and bickering. The corrupt man.
You're just a general. We are the Senate. Senatus. Patres and conscripti. The center. The heart. The fullness of Rome. You will oppose the will of the Roman Senate? The heart of Rome?
It is a new father.
Let it be known in the four corners of the empire that this is my son, Aëtius, Patris, Majorian, the future commander of all the Roman armies, my son.
Hello, my name is Ivan Pavletich. And I'm the creator behind this story of 476 AD. I'm the writer and director of it. What you have seen now is the first book, chapter one, The Last Light of Ares. And I hope you already have seen the first movie, 476 AD, chapter one, The Last Light of Ares, of which now you've seen the trailer. And now we're going to go towards chapter two. Now, chapter one deals with the last 25 years before the final demise of Western Roman Empire in 476 AD. So it deals with the time period from 451 AD to 476 AD. It deals with 451 because it was a very crucial year at the very end of Western Roman Empire. It was the year when General Flavius Aëtius defeated Attila the Hun, and that was very crucial because Flavius Aëtius was one of the last golden age of Rome, golden age generals. He was actually known as the savior of Rome. So what you see in the movie Gladiator, where there is a Maximus, actually there was never a Maximus. A Maximus is actually based on General Flavius Aetius, who really did exist in 451 AD and really brought Rome its own self back, kind of a thing. And the whole aspect of a jealous Caesar who ends up murdering the general because the general was more popular than Caesar himself is actually the case with Flavius Aetius and the Caesar Emperor Valentinian III, which couldn't stand the fact that one general, Flavius Aetius, would be more popular than the Caesar, the emperor himself. So the emperor actually had Flavius Aetius murdered. So actually that story really happened in that chapter one that we saw. That's really the true aspect where it happened. Anyways, what I tried to depict with chapter one is that last slide, that last spark of the old antiquity, the old age of Ares, which was destroyed through the corruption and the corrosion within the Roman Senate, actually, and which brought then to the second book, book two, chapter two, Dawning of the Age of Pisces, which is a far darker book, darker chapter, dealing with the actual fall of Rome in 476 AD. So I want to present you the trailer for chapter 2, and then we will talk some more about it. Welcome back. So, what you saw now was the trailer for Chapter 2, Dawning of the Age of Pisces. Now, the second chapter is a far darker chapter. It deals with the far colder aspects of human psyche. And, you know, talking about the human psyche, I wanted to depict a sort of a more, maybe not a nightmarish, but sort of a darker, scarier, dreamy kind of state of mind, which comes from a combination of depression and sadness. But I wouldn't necessarily mix depression with sadness, because depression is more on the physical aspect of, like, body chemistry and brain chemistry. I would say rather it's you're awake, but you're remembering the times that were through a certain sad momentum. So it's more of a sad memory kind of thing. It is like facing the depiction of the cold, dark ages with a sadness of memory, remembering the good times there, which were, but you were not truly fully aware of the good times when they really were good times. So I think the primary difference and the primary element that I wanted to depict at 476, the entire concept, is this shift in the change of state of mind in the human psyche, going from the last light of Aries, sort of, you know, the age of Aries, which stands for the astrological age, like the age of Aquarius, sort of like the last age of antiquity, the more lighter age, the more easier age, kind of the more fiery, warmer time period where, you know, sexual freedom was more open, the expression was more open, there were sports, things are more clearer. And then we enter a darker chapter, which is chapter 2, Dawning of the Age of Pisces, which deals with that more medieval times, the Dark Ages, the time period of the church dogma, the church dominion, or really our states of mind and the human evolution. You know, the women were put down, women were even burned on stakes, and humor was forbidden. A lot of elements that existed in ancient Greece and Rome, you know, in this entire Greco-Roman time of antiquity, was suddenly completely shut down. I mean, there was about 1,000 years of dark ages, which ended up with a cataclysmic bubonic plague in the 14th century, you know, the culmination of total weakness of the human psyche. And this is something that I try to depict with this 476 AD concept, is that shift in the state of mind going from one extreme to another. But in that middle, sort of when the fire meets water, you have that kind of smoke going on. You get that cloudy smog of uncertainty. And the chapter 2 it goes into that direction. There's a whole sequence, which will you now see in the actual movie. There's a whole sequence of a dream, of a nightmare, of a premonition of the future, which I wanted to show, call it Nostradamus type of a premonition, but sort of a correlation between the shift between Aries and dawning of the age of Pisces, let's say some 1600 years ago, and then sort of that dawning of the age of Aquarius, an interesting paradoxical correlation with 1969 Woodstock kind of shift and change in the state of mind of the sexual revolution, freedom of thought, freedom of expression, and a lot of things that were not around just a decade before, let's say 1969. And there's this parallel that I wanted to depict, but I wanted to depict it as a time period before that. And let me just show you the movie and you experience it on your own. Enjoy.
for some time now about these potential developments in Rome. But we must not jump to any quick conclusion. The situation is delicate, my friends, I know. To any mindless speculations. We must negotiate a solution as the Senate always has. Therefore, the Senate cannot succumb to any. Simplistic solutions. My Caesar.
My Caesar, honorable senators of Rome.
General Aëtius.
Yes, my Caesar.
What news do you bring us?
Odoacer and his army of Ostrogoths have sacked the city of Ravenna. They're on their way here. I'm afraid the omens are bad, my Caesar.
Omens? And what omens would that be, General Aëtius? Honorable Romans, citizens, senators of Rome, do you hear what our honorable patriot majorum would tell us? We're doomed!
As commander of all the Roman armies, I don't feel adequately appropriate reporting to you, honorable senator.
Oh, but this is the Roman Senate. The will of the people of Rome.
My Caesar, we should start to evacuate the city.
Rome has existed for over 1,000 years, young Aëtius. For all those centuries, the Senate of Rome has been the heart of Rome. Rome cannot fall.
Evacuate? You think you can predict the omens of Rome? Change the will of Rome? You're just a general. We are the Senate. Senatus! Patres et conscripti! The center, the heart, the fathers of Rome! You would oppose the will of the Roman Senate? The heart of Rome?
Fathers of Rome. Heart? You? Look around you. Can't you see what's happening? You want to talk about the heart? You want to talk about the heart of Rome? You must first have a heart.
We have our Caesar.
Rome has existed for over 1,000 years. It is the center of the world. Rome. Not fall.
And as long as we have our Caesar, we have our heart.
Heart. Heart. Like my father. My father was the better man.
He was beyond that bickering and greed that corrupts man.
That's why he had to go.
That's why he had to be killed. That's why he had to go. Isn't it? Isn't it? How could you ever run with a man like Libius Aëtius in your way? It's unnatural to your kind. All that Rome is worth to you is the value of denarii you've been selling it for all these years. I've just come from the gates of Rome. I've seen the barbarians. I've smelled them. Thousands of them. Ready to come in and attack at any time. Wake up! Our Rome is falling!
Aëtius.
Yes, my Caesar.
Dear Aëtius. Patrius Majorian, you, of all the warriors of Rome, the most Roman of them all. I remember you when I was a little boy, and out of all the defenders of Rome, I always looked up to you the most. The true defender of Rome.
My Caesar, we can still get you to safety. We must leave now. Their carriage is outside ready to take you as we speak. But we must leave. There's no more time. The south of Rome is still defended by the legions. We can take you as far as Napolis tonight. From where the galleys will take you to the island of Capri. There you would be safe for the moment. And then, via Sicily, we can transport you all the way to Constantinople in the east.
Aëtius.
Yes, my Caesar.
My dear Aëtius. I can't leave. I belong here. These are my people. Oh, my dear General Aëtius. If it is the will of God that Rome shall fall, then my place is with her. Remembered as Romulus Augustulus, who stood with Rome until the end.
Yes, my Caesar.
So is my will, and the will of the people. Go on now, my friend. Defend our Rome. Give it your best. Strength and honor.
Strength and honor.
bastards! Those arrogant bastards. I felt I was right about the Senate, that's why.
Every man knows his position. We're ready. You have a good army behind you. We have at least a day before they come. There's still some time. Go to her, Aëtius. Go to your wife.
can't I feel you? Why?
Valeria, it's not that easy.
Why? Why are we so beautiful and filled with so much dread? What is wrong? Tell me.
Thank you.
Come back to me.
I don't know. I don't know. We'll lead the armies tomorrow because
I love you. Why must it be my husband? My husband. My husband. Why? My husband! Why? Son of a bitch, I hate you! Man in their war! Why? This fucking war!
Valeria, look at me. It's okay.
Come back to me. Understand? You come back to me.
I'll come back to you, Valeria. I promise.
Thank you. son. Son. One day,
and welcome back. So I hoped you liked this, what I call it, my Schubert's Eighth Unfinished Symphony, kind of the unfinished cut, the unfinished version of the sequel, Chapter 2, Dawning of the Age of Pisces. I cut this version, this cut, I cut right at the battle sequence, multiple reasons, primarily financial budget restraints, because a lot of this, a lot of the budgeting for the, which was required for the CGI rotoscoping, motion tracking, multiplication of characters. You know, a lot of it costs a lot of money, and there have been some problems regarding the finishing. But so I sort of left for the time being this cut, this chapter two, Dawning of the Age of Pisces, a little bit like what I call a Schubert's unfinished. You know, when you look at the budget restraints and then the compromising of the quality versus getting something more fashionable, it is for us the more poor indie non-Hollywood low budget style filmmakers, the actual physics of it, the physicality of the actual production becomes more technical. It becomes more realistic. As much as I consider myself an artist, you know, you need money to actually make something happen. So, like, you can make a movie with little money, but you cannot make a movie with no money. You know, just the uniforms alone, just all the armor and all the shields and everything that you saw in both chapters, that alone cost me from my own pocket some $27,000 or so. This was, what, 5 years ago. You know, a lot of this project was pretty much paid from my own pocket, mostly. And when you look at it, it's sometimes you have to make things happen because you have the vision and the time is right. And if you wait too much for, you know, companies, distribution companies, and etc., you know, production companies, these big houses, getting your project ahead and investing something like $50 million of their own money into it, you know, you might end up just waiting forever. And sometimes you just have to bite the bullet and make the best out of what you have. And what I'd like to suggest, you know, to future filmmakers, to any, you know, young, passionate filmmakers who have a vision, don't be afraid. You know, if there's a lack of self-confidence, a lack of that certain element of insecurity, what the society might think, what the audience might think, you know, the society expectations, don't worry about it, because if you have the artistic vision now, and you know it is the right thing, the momentum is here, the time is right, don't worry about what somebody might think and say, because the truth is permanent. That which you do from your heart right now will make sense. If not now, in 5 years, in 10 years from now, in 20 years from now, in 30 years from now. If it is true, it'll make sense. You know, art as an art form, be that filmmaking or my real art is painting and drawing. I've been a painter and a drawer artist primarily all of my life. And, you know, as a painter, I know that when you paint and draw something, you're not doing it for the society's expectations. You're really doing it from your heart. And I think that's really what matters. Be that music, same thing. If you're writing music from your heart and you feel it, it is the right thing to do. Trust me, it will last if it is honest. So whatever you do, make sure it comes from the heart. Make sure that it is true. And don't worry what others will say. Don't worry about fashion. Fashion comes and goes, but that which is true from the heart will stay, and it will remain permanent. And I think with this, call it experiment, let's say, which is one of my experiments, it's not the only one, but the 476 AD concept saga, it is something that I think is meant to make you think. At least I'm hoping so. It's meant to make you possibly open your sixth sense. You know, open your eyes a little bit, open your mind a little bit. You know, I think that thought versus just reaction, you know, momentary gratification, is sometimes better. I think the dreamy state of mind, which is depicted in chapter two, for instance, in Dawning of the Age of Pisces, I think this dreamy state of mind you know, what you saw with that nightmare sequence sort of sums up this concept that I have tried to achieve. And, you know, I can only wonder how will this concept be perceived in 10 years from now, and how will it be perceived in 20 years from now. I only hope that the primary concept which deals with these human epochs, you know, this evolutionary state of mind, is depicted in a way that that society, or, you know, public or audience, whatever you want to call it, will remember this. At least that's what I hope as an artist. So I hope you enjoyed this, and see you next time.